right, I'm out in Spring Point area today, looking at a canola field. Looks like it has had some grasshopper feeding in here, and I am able to find a couple of grasshoppers in here. So I'm thinking that is the likely culprit. It could also be army worms. So I'm gonna take a square foot worth of canola plants here, and I'm gonna go beat them out on the hood of my truck and see how many worms we find. All right, so let's take our square foot of canola plants, beat it out on the hood of the truck, and we look for worms. And don't see anything. Looks pretty good. Not a one. So I'm gonna say that the damage that we see out there is grasshoppers, not army worms. All right, and here's one of the culprits right here who's been chewing away on the pod. Big fat buggers out here, right up against some grazeland. So there's quite a few grasshoppers, and you can see the fresh damage. He's been chewing on that pod right there. All right, just checking out another canola field, getting really heavy grasshopper feeding around the edges here. And here's something interesting. Here's a grasshopper that died from either a disease or from a parasite. Judging by the hole in the back end there, I would say probably a parasite. So that's kind of nice to see. But they are sure chewing the crap out of some of these greener canola pods in here. There's, if you think ligus can do a lot of damage late in the season, think again. Grasshoppers in a case like this can do far more damage than a ligus can. All right, old boy, Spring Point today, and this is a fairly late green feed crop. And we've had lots and lots of rain up here, and you can see it's really showing in the disease pressure here. You can see we got a lot of blotch going on in here. Quite a lot. There's also some smut developing here and there in the field, but mostly we're looking at blotch. Well, you know you've had good rainfall in your fields when you have stuff like this going on down here. That's a Beyond Meat burger patty with a whole pile of mushrooms growing on her. Checking out some dry land barley by Nobleford. Some of these fields got hailed pretty good. And you can see we got a whole pile of Volunteer that's coming up. Still just one leaf. So we're going to wait for 2-3 leaf stage here, and then we're going to spray. We're not quite sure what the rotation is going to be for next year yet, so we're going to use Blackhawk with the Roundup, and that's going to give us better kochia control and still really good flexibility for next year. We could even seed canola in here with no problems as long as you spray Blackhawk before freeze up. Soybeans are coming along pretty nicely this week. We're still developing very well. Pods are filling out. We're pretty much at edamame stage here now. So they're still quite soft, but we are filling out pretty good in here. Checking out cornfields over by Nobleford today, and we're into blister stage here for the most part now. So that's when you can see, well, basically it looks like blisters on top of where the corn kernel should be. And so that's just basically really early milk stage filling. And it'll give you a good idea of how well you did on fertilization. So you can actually see here there's one that didn't get fertilized. One here, there's a couple kind of here and there, so that doesn't surprise me on this, because this was right around the edge of a field, and it's never quite as good around the edge, but likely around the tip here too we got some that are not going to fill. You can't see any blister on them. Checking out the dryland mustard by Fort McLeod today, and unfortunately a fair portion of this field got hit by hail, and it shelled out pretty good here. And a little bit has been combined, and you can see the volume of Volunteer on the ground from the hail is pretty high. So we'll have to take care of that after harvest is done. Just checking out a flax field over by Nobleford for desiccation timing. Overall, the field is pretty well turned, but there is a couple green strips and some green patches in it. And so what you want to look at for desiccation in flax is 75% to 80% of the bolls you want to have turned brown. So this plant, for example, would be maybe 50%, so it's still fairly green. But the vast majority of these are 75% to 80%, with only the odd green plant here and there. So in this case, this would be an optimum time for a desiccation application in here. And either Reglone or Ion or glyphosate is going to be a product of choice for flax, and either one is still probably going to take 2 weeks for things to dry down. Flax is pretty slow to dry down generally. Keep going, come on. This is how Fenn gets through thick canola. Oh, are you getting tired? Here's a couple good examples of Sclerotinia affected canola that I just pulled out of a field here. So this is kind of classic early infection. It's fairly low down on the stem. The whole stem is basically just dead. There's a couple sclerotia bodies inside there. And you can see all the pods, the tops are just completely crispy. And here on this one, we've got a little bit of a higher infection. And you can see sclerotia is right in there. And this one side branch here is still a bit on the green side, but everything else is rapidly turning. And just for an estimate of yield loss, generally, if you have, say, a 5% infection rate by Sclerotinia, you could expect about half of that to be yield loss. So a 5% infection would be about a 2.5% yield loss. 20% infection, 10% yield loss. Here's the alder on wheat down near Colehurst today, and we are starting to dry down a bit here, but we're still a little ways away from swath timing yet. The kernels are still very soft. We want to get down to about that 30% moisture before we swath, and these are still quite soft. You can easily cut through them with a thumbnail, so we're going to have to wait probably at least another week. Very slow maturing variety. Alright, I think it's harvest time for a couple of my little wheat trial plots, so I'm going to try these ones today. These are irrigated wheat, but it's feeling like it's pretty well dried down. So I'm going to hand thrash out a sample, check the moisture on it, and if it's good, I'm going to go in here, and what I'm going to do, because I don't have any small equipment, and the plots are too small to hit with big equipment and get any rough idea of yield at 10 by 20 feet, I'm going to go in and I'm going to take, say, all the plants out of, we'll say, 3 feet of a seed row. I'm going to hand thrash those out on my screens here, collect the samples, and then I'm going to take that and get it precisely weighed, and that'll at least give me an idea. It's not going to be precise, it's not going to be ideal, but it's what I've got to work with. And here's what I'm left for a grain sample after hand threshing 3 feet of seed row. It doesn't look too bad, but could be cleaned up a bit more. Just having a hard time getting the seeds out of some of these glooms here by hand, but hopefully I can clean it up in a better set of screens later on. Moisture testing 9.3, so I'm going to do this 6 more times and take the samples home to weigh them on a precision scale. And as I'm picking through these trials, in order to try to get some consistency, I'm actually taking my sample from the same seed row that's running perpendicular through all of the plots. Seed rows are running this way, plots are running this way, so I'm only taking out of this seed row right here in order to try to keep things consistent. Alright, well, I got her done, but I don't think the dog survived very well. He's kind of bored to death here, but anyways, that's all the samples. The last three, however, these guys, moisture levels are pretty high on them. So the Nature's Aid, the Isle, and the Lignajule are all pretty high in moisture, so I'm going to have to dry these down or run some calculations to even things out. Alright, I'm out here at one of the larger farms, just checking some combine progress. Everything's coming along pretty well. And I just thought I'd show quick how cool some of the stuff on Farmer's Edge is. So here I can see all the combines in the field, where they are, updated roughly about every minute. And as you can see here, I can kind of roughly calculate out yield. Grain moisture is all there, how fast they're going, what the sieve loss is. So you can really see when somebody hits a kochia pocket or something like that, sieve loss can really go up. But yeah, it's pretty cool. I like to be able to follow along and get a pretty good guess as to what's going on out here. Interestingly enough, this swarm of bees that was here last week is still here. So that's kind of cool. Well, it looks like I was 1 or 2 hours too slow to get this wheat trial harvested. And yeah, no doubt of there. Here's a couple cobs out of the Pioneer 58 AM Liberty Tolerant corn over by Lethbridge. You can see we're out of the blister stage now, we're into the milk stage. Kernels have filled out very nice. We got some real nice looking cobs going on in here. So, very, very nice overall. Flying cornfields with a drone is sure handy. It gives you a really good way to get over the field quick and make sure there's no drowned out spots or anything. This field is very even, very nice. Just a couple of these spots where somebody, Cody, forgot to put some seed down here and there. And now it's time for question of the week. And the answer to last week's question of the week on what groups of action are you seeing here on these weeds, that would be group 4 and group 6. So this was sprayed with Enforcer M, which is safe on oats, and the active ingredients are fluroxypyr plus MCPA ester, which is your group 4s, and then bromoxynil group 6. Here's a good question of the week for you guys this week. What are we seeing here? This is the symptoms of what in corn?
Okay, well, don't videotape me.
Yeah. Okay, well, today is Kirsten's last day in the office. Next week, she's off to Saskaberia to go back to school. And we will hopefully see her again next year.
Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe, and we'll see you next week.